Hello, good evening to all of you. Good to see you through the screen. Today is going to be the last episode of the lessons from the Seventh Church of Revelation. So we are planning to conclude this study today, part 15. Am I right, Sean? Yes, part 15. And it's been also a marathon run with this study, but thank God we are able to complete it with all the challenges with these power cuts and all of that. We never stopped. That's purely the grace of God. Amen. And so let's dive into the study. Let's get together and pray and commit ourselves to the Holy Spirit of God. Precious Holy Spirit of God, thank you for this privilege. Thank you that you're speaking to us today. Thank you for this privilege of bringing your word to many homes through the screen. Thank you for giving us electricity and all of these facilities. We are truly grateful. May your word touch and transform your people, change their hearts, and bring a spiritual revival within them. Thank you for being with us and helping us to do this study. We give you all the glory to you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Okay, so what we are studying is Lessons from the Seven Churches of Revelation, part 15. So today, as we conclude this study, next week we will take a break and then we will let you know what is the topic that we are going to start on Fridays. Okay, so basically we were looking at the end time studies on Fridays, am I right? That's how we started during the second lockdown, and it has continued. And here we are, we're still continuing. So let's see what's the next topic would be. And I would like to keep the future studies as short as possible so that many can follow. So far we have covered all the seven churches: Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Laodicea we could not finish last week. So today we finish with Laodicea. And then we are done with the seven churches and the lessons that we learn from these churches. Because Jesus wrote seven letters to these churches. He appreciated them for their work, and also he reprimanded them and rebuked them for their faults. So we were learning from these churches through their mistakes. We are learning and we correct ourselves. So what is the lesson that we are learning from these seven churches? That's what we were mainly focusing on. So what was the problem with the Laodicea church? Lukewarmness, am I right? They were neither hot nor cold. That was their problem. And Jesus was so disgusted with them. Being a church, still Jesus was disgusted. He said, "You taste so awful in my mouth, I am about to spit you out of my mouth because you're lukewarm." That was the problem of the Laodicea church. So how did they come to this place of lukewarmness? We looked at this last week because they were so rich. Can you believe? The blessings of God can bring you to a place of lukewarmness. That's how subtle the devil is. The Lord blesses you, and then the devil uses the same blessing to bring you to a place of lukewarmness. You're neither hot nor cold. You're neither in the kingdom nor in the world, caught in between. That was the problem of the Laodicea church. So they were physically very rich, which led them to lukewarm state. You know, mostly in the Western country, this Western world, they were once, strong Christian countries. But now, if you see, most of these countries have become atheists. You know, yesterday I was talking to a precious lady who came from Australia, yeah. And she wanted to meet me because she follows our services from Australia. So she was down here for a wedding, and she came to meet me. And she was telling, "Pastor, it's very sad that Australia is an atheistic country. They don't believe in God." Why? Because they have all the blessings. So they say, "Why do I need God? I have everything what I want. Why do I need to seek God? So the Laodicea church came to a place of so blessed, they even excluded God. They were just nominal namesake Christians. And it was so disrespectful to God. And God was so, Jesus was so upset about this situation. And he said, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth because you taste so awful. I explained to you about the water problem in Laodicea. Can you remember all of that? So Jesus takes that very practical scenario in the city what they had and applied it to their spiritual life. That's how Jesus is so practical. So let's begin from where we left last week. Let's turn our Bibles to Revelation chapter 3. Okay, that's where the letter is. I hope that you have your Bible. Turn your Bibles. Don't depend on the screen. Turn your Bibles. Turn your book to a page and start writing notes and search the scriptures and see what I'm saying is true. Okay? Verse 18, look what Jesus says. He's telling to the Laodicea church, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and a salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Three things Jesus is saying to the Laodicea church. Number one, he's saying, buy gold from me. Buy gold from me. I counsel you to buy gold refined in the fire, number one, so you can become rich. And then he's saying, I want to give you white clothes to wear your shamefulness and your nakedness. And I want to give you a salve, a medicine, to put your eyes so that you can see. So, in other words, Jesus is telling the Laodicea church, you are rich but yet poor. You have all the rich clothes but still you are naked and shameful. And you have eyes you cannot see. This is what Jesus is trying to tell the Laodicea church. You know, they were physically wealthy but spiritually impoverished. That was the Christians in Laodicea. Jesus says, come buy from me refined gold. Come to my shop and buy things that money cannot buy. That's what Jesus was telling. Come and buy from me refined gold. That's what he was saying. They knew about gold. You know, when all of these letters I showed you how Jesus was practical, what did I say about the Laodicea city? They were the central for banking system in the Asia Minor. They were the headquarters, kind of headquarters, for the banking system in the Asia Minor countries. So they knew about gold because there were plenty of gold because of the banking system. So that's why Jesus is saying, come and buy from me refined gold. Why gold is gold? Because it has gone through fire. Why gold is expensive? Because it is purified through fire. It's the metal that is so purified. No other metal can go through such intense heat and fire. Gold has gone through it. So the refined gold reflects the character. That's why, you know, the Bible says, in the house of God, you will find vessels of hay, wood, bronze, silver, and gold. So there are people in the house of God who have gone through fire and been purified and refined. They are like vessels of gold. They are full of character. So Jesus is looking at the Laodicea church members and saying, you have money, folks, but you don't have character. Are you hearing me, church? Are you with me? So he was talking about, you know, character and strength in the midst of pressure. I want you to make strong Christians with character, become my children with character. That's what Jesus was trying to tell the Laodicea church. You know, today, don't you find many Christians who have money, but they don't have character, Christ-like character? Have you come across Christians like that? I have come across in the churches. They have money, character. You don't see the characteristics of Christ in them. But they have money. Today, many churches are promoting that. Their doctrine is such that they say you need to become millionaires and billionaires, but not about character. Character doesn't matter. Some pastors are pastoring churches. They are divorced, but they talk about only money and becoming millionaires and billionaires, but they don't talk about character. Because why? Even the pastor does not have Christ-like character. So such is the status even today in churches. Are you with me, church? But Christ, Jesus, is vehemently coming against the Laodicea church and says, buy from me refined gold. In other words, he's saying, buy from me character, which your money cannot buy. So first of all, before becoming millionaires and billionaires, let us have the character of Christ. Let us have the fruits of the Holy Spirit before money. Are you with me, church? And he is also telling, I'm selling white robes, come and buy. What does the white robes reflect throughout in the scripture? Righteousness. Righteousness. Righteous deeds are the garment of righteousness, says the book of Revelation. So Jesus is saying, you have money, Laodicea church. You don't have character. You don't have righteous deeds. So buy character from me and buy righteousness from me. That's what Jesus was telling. Come to me, I'll give you righteousness so that you can have access to my holiness. And then he was talking about their eyes were blinded by their wealth, riches, and affluence of the city. He's saying, come to me, I will open your eyes to a different truth. Are you with me, church? So the most important and the best things in life comes from Jesus, and they are free. You know, the most important thing and the best thing in things in life are free, but you can't buy it with your money. You have to come to Jesus. They are free, but so expensive. So Jesus wraps the letter with a very compelling picture. Very compelling picture. What is that? Go to verse 20. Goes to verse 20. He says, here I am. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. Now, precious people of God, this scripture, Revelation 3:20, today, most often churches use to bring somebody to Christ who have never received him before. Am I right in saying that? They quote this scripture to someone who's never born again, never part of the church, and say, Jesus is at the door of your heart, he's knocking. Open your door of your heart, he will come into your life. We speak to a non-believer and quote this scripture. But this scripture, originally, Jesus speak to a church, a born-again church. He's saying, you are a Christian, you are a child of God, and you belong to a church, but I am outside your heart. I am outside of your heart and I'm knocking. If you hear my voice and open your heart, I will come in. Why? The Laodicea church was so rich, they have excluded God, excluded Jesus, saying, Can you remember I told you when the earthquake hit the city, they said to the emperor, "No thanks, we don't need your help. We are self-sufficient. We can look after ourselves. We can build our city on our own." And the same approach they had towards the church, had towards Jesus rather. The church said, when God wants to come into life, "No thanks, we can look after ourselves. We have money." Jesus said, "I'm outside of your heart. I'm outside of your heart. You are in the church. You are a member of the church. You belong, you call yourself Christian. You call yourself that I'm a worshiper of Jesus, but I'm outside of your heart." You know, I can remember, it's such a phenomenal thing that happened in my life. I hope that I can finish it today. I must finish it. But anyway, as I'm reminded by the Holy Spirit, I'm going to tell you this story. You know, I came to know the Lord through one of my good friend. He was a Hindu, and he was not educated much. He studied in the Kandapura Mahavidyalaya. Maximum, I believe, he studied to grade 8 or 9. He didn't do his O-levels even. He was not good in his studies. He used to have a bicycle shop and repair bicycles. So he was one of my good friend. So when I came from college during holiday time, study leave time, he's the one who took me to AOG Church because he has become born again. Now he wants to take his good friend to the Lord. And that's how I came to know the Lord. So I'm not very, good at, Tamil and I prefer going to English service. So he used to wait till the Tamil service was in the morning. So he used to wait in the church till evening to make sure that I attend the English service. So precious people of God, he can't speak a word of English. He can't speak. I know my friend, he can't speak a word of English. Even if you speak to him in English, he will reply to you in Sinhala or Tamil. So while we were worshiping God, he spoke in proper grammar and beautiful English, and he said, "You all are worshiping, I am outside the church." Everyone is shocked. Why? He can't speak a word of English. It's a tongue for him. In other words, he spoke in tongues. English is a tongue. And he was saying, "You all are worshiping, but I'm outside the church." And the church had to repent and say, "We are sorry, God." And there's the same story about the Laodicea church. Jesus is saying, "Hey guys, I am at the door. I'm not inside. And I'm knocking. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me." Isn't that such a sad status? Today in many Christians' life, they call themselves Christians. They attend church, they're members of church, but their life is far away from Jesus. Their life, they have excluded Christ. Maybe they are rich. They think, "I don't need God. I just come to church. It's a tradition. It's a ritual. My families have been Christians and I've attended church from my small days. But for that sake, I come. I don't have a personal relationship with Jesus. My money is more than enough for me." That was the status of the Laodicea. Very sad, isn't it? So, Jesus says, "I will come in and eat with that person and they with me." You know, why did he say that? During those days in this city, dining lasted for hours. They used to sit and talk and eat for hours. That was one of the culture in this city. So what Jesus was, when he said, "I will come in and eat with that person and they with me," he was showing them, "I want to have that fellowship with you. I want to have that relationship with you. How you guys sit together and eat and talk for hours, the same thing I want to do with you. I want to come into that inner circle, into your intimate life circle, and I want to have fellowship with you. I want to spend quality time with you, hours." That's what Jesus was trying to tell to the Laodicea church. And maybe somebody who's watching me, that's what Jesus is trying to tell you. Don't keep me outside. I want to come into your inner circle, inside of you, and I want to have fellowship time, quality time with you. So, precious child of God, this invitation is interpreted in two ways. Those who have not received Christ, he wants to come into your life. Those who have received but excluded him, he wants to come into you. So the invitation is interpreted in two ways. So if you see, all of these letters begins with the introduction of the greatness of Jesus. See, all the letters, it talks about the greatness of Jesus. But it is so sad, the letters end with him excluded from the children of God. Something is wrong with it. That's why he sends a letter rebuking them, saying, change, change. Have you excluded Christ? Christianity is just a religion for you. Are you a person that once walked with Christ and now that you don't have an intimate relationship with him? Just search your heart. Are you that lukewarm person? Are you that person who has compromised? Are you that person who's get-along culture? Search your heart. It's time to return back to Christ, to that intimate relationship with him. You know, the material blessings are a bonus, but not a distraction. The material blessings are a bonus, definitely, but they are not a distraction. They should not distract you from Christ. Let money and material things be in your pocket and God be in your heart. What has happened to the Laodicean Christians? They have taken God out of their heart and put the money and the material blessings into their heart. That's why Jesus is saying, I want to get back into your heart. The heart belongs to Jesus. Money and material things belongs to your pocket. Let not your money and material things get into your heart. Always the center of your heart must belong to Jesus. Are you hearing me, church? Very important. Very important. The day money and material blessings get into your heart, lukewarm is inevitable. When do you get lukewarm? When material blessings and money gets into your heart and exclude Christ. That's what happened to the Laodicean church. Let's bring Christ into the center of our heart. Let's look at this letter, what he wrote to the Laodicea church, and let's bring Christ into the center of our heart. Let Jesus be in the center of our heart. Nothing satisfies life like Jesus. Amen. You know, at the end of all life, who will win is Jesus, not money and not material things. All, you know, at the end, the Bible says the fire will end and melt everything. No matter whatever expensive vehicle that you have, no matter how palatial house that you live in, all things will pass away. Only the word of God will remain, which is Christ. He will be the victor. Open your heart to him today and say, invite him into your heart and say, Jesus, I want you to be in the center of my heart. Nothing else, God. You know, the churches all over the world are becoming lukewarm because of the materialism creeping into the church. Are you hearing me? Materialism, worldliness is materialism. And materialism is creeping into the church and replacing Christ. That's why today, if you listen to many churches, what you hear from the pulpit is all about money, money, money. How to become the next billionaire. How to financially prosper. 7 ways to financially prosper. The secret recipe for financial prosperity. You know, all to do with money, money. Materialism is creeping into the church and lukewarmness is creeping into believers' life. Beware, precious people of God. Remember the Laodicea church. Remember. No, the believers don't take a stand for anything. Indifference had led to idleness. By neglecting to do anything for Christ, the churches had become hardened and self-satisfied, and it is destroying itself. It's a letter of warning that Jesus wrote to the Laodicea church. It's relevant to churches even today. There is nothing worse than a half-hearted nominal Christian who is self-sufficient. Don't settle for following God halfway, precious child of God. Be sold out for Christ. Let the Holy Spirit set us on fire to burn for Christ. Amen. You know, some believers assume that numerous material possessions are a sign of God's spiritual blessing and God is standing with them. You know, today many churches also teach us that. They believe that as much as they prosper, and they have wealth and money and material things, that's a sign that God is with them. Laodicea church was such a rich church. But was God with them? No. God said, I'm vomitish of yourself. I want to spit you out of my mouth. You have wealth. You have money. So then the Laodicea church should say, oh, we are so rich. And this is a sign that God is with us. Money and material blessings alone is not a sign that God is with you, precious child of God. I am not, you know, writing off rich Christians. There are rich Christians who truly walk with God, who passionately walk with God. They know where to keep the money and where to keep God. But there are preachings and teaching from the pulpit saying, if you are prospering and if you have luxury vehicles, if you live in a palatial house, that is a sign that God is with you. So they are raising up Christians with money and not characteristics of Christ. So money alone is not a sign that God is with them. So don't look at a Christian and say, oh, they have money, so God is with them. Look whether they have the characteristics of Christ, not the money. Amen. So Laodicea was the wealthiest among the seven cities, and the church was also wealthy, but what the Laodicean could see and buy had become more valuable to them than what is unseen. You know, wealth and luxury can make a believer feel confident, satisfied, and complacent. But no matter how much you possess, or how much money you make, you have nothing if you don't have a vital, strong relationship. You know, God would discipline this lukewarm church unless it turned from its indifference towards Him. God's purpose in discipline is not to punish, but to bring people back to Him. Are you hearing me, church? Why does God discipline us? Because this church, God was disciplining because of their lukewarmness. And why God is disciplining them is because He loves them and He wants to bring them back to Him. So are you lukewarm in your devotion towards God? God may discipline you to help you out of your uncaring attitude, but He uses only loving discipline. Okay, so God uses discipline. Whom I love, I discipline. Look at the verse 19. What does God say? Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. That's what He said to the Laodicea church. I know that you're rich, but you have become lukewarm. So I am rebuking you and I am going to discipline you. Why? I love you and I want you back to me. That's what sometimes some Christians God wants. First morning, second morning, third morning. They don't listen, and then God sends a discipline on them. Not because he hates them, because he loves them. He wants to bring them back to him. So how does your current level of wealth affect your spiritual desire? Just ask these questions. Instead of centering your life primarily on comfort and luxury, find your true riches in Christ. No matter how much of money you have, how much of wealth you have, no matter how luxury vehicle that you drive, even if you have 3-4 luxury vehicles and you live in Columbus 7 in a palatial house, you might have properties abroad, let them not control you. Let Holy Spirit of God, so that Christ will be in the center. All the other things, what you see externally, are going to pass away one day. And one day you have to leave them all and go. Can you take your house beyond the grave? Can you take your vehicle beyond the grave? No. What you can take, you know, Jesus asked two beautiful questions. He said, what is the profit if a man inherits the whole world and loses his soul? Number one question. Number two, what can a man give in exchange for his soul? Beyond the grave, for your soul, you can't give anything in exchange. Okay? So, know your priorities. Don't be like the Laodicea church. The problem with the Laodicea church was lukewarmness. The lukewarmness was because of the result of their wealth. So God is not telling you to be poor. God is not against rich people or richness or wealthiness. No. Bible says, though he was rich, he became poor. That through his poverty, we are made rich. The word rich is talking about material things. So God wants you to prosper. God wants you to do well and have riches and live a wealthy, blessed life. But he does not want you to give your heart to the riches and the wealth and the money and the material things. He wants you to secure a heart, and he wants you to give your heart to him and him alone. Let the riches and wealthiness and money and material things be on the outside. Let your heart be controlled by the Holy Spirit. This is the lesson that we learn from the Laodicea church. So with that, I close about the Laodicea church. So the final summary. What have you learned from the seven churches of Asia Minor? What have you learned? What have you learned from the seven letters that Jesus wrote to the seven churches? What did you learn about Ephesus, the church in Ephesus? Don't lose your first love. If you have lost your first love, what is first love? How to know that I have lost my first love? Go back and learn, you know, listen to the study. What have you learned from Smyrna? Stay true to Christ in the face of persecution and poverty. Stay focused and true to Christ in the face of persecution and poverty. That's what you learn from Smyrna. What do you learn from Pergamum? Don't live a compromised life. Don't live a compromised life. What do you learn from Thyatira? Don't give in to immorality. What do you learn from Sardis? Don't give in to get-along culture. All of this we learned. If you joined us first time today, you have to go back and listen to all of this to understand what I'm telling. Philadelphia, what did you learn? Hold on to the good things till the end. Hold on to the good things that I've given you till the end. Finally, Laodicea, let not the riches lead you to lukewarmness. So this is the lessons that we learn from the seven letters to the seven churches. The precious child of God, today we are finishing this study after 15 episodes. Thank God for his faithfulness, his grace that he gave us to finish this study. I want to thank Sean especially. He has been right throughout there for these 15 episodes, faithfully handling all the systems. Thank Timothy also being there to help this, to bring these studies to your home. And I believe that you are blessed by this study, and all glory to God. Amen. Hoping to see all those who joined for the Saturday fasting and prayer time. Last Saturday, we didn't have electricity, but we never gave up. We made sure that we connect through the phones, and we had a solid 1.5 hours time praying for the country. Precious children of God, all of this shaking is maybe God has put his hand. Did you hear me? Maybe you think, oh, everything is chaotic and what's happening? Because we prayed, God has put his hand. And all of this shaking may end up in a good thing, may have a good ending, because God is in control. He has never lost control. Okay? So come on Saturdays, let's get together and pray. Even if there is power cut, never mind, join through your phone. We don't need to see your face. We only need to hear your voice. If you have time, if you love this country, if you love this nation, protesting is good, but more than protesting, prayer is more important. Bible says, pray for the leaders. Pray for the leaders of their country so that you will live in peace. So prayer is a priority for a child of God if you love this country. Amen. So come together. Let's get together and pray on Saturday, fasting and prayer time, 6 p.m. Thank you, everyone, for being so faithful to this ministry. I want to thank everyone who financially support this ministry so that we can do what God has called us to do. Thank you for being faithful to this ministry and remaining and standing with this ministry. May the Lord bless you, make his face to shine upon you. May God's goodness and mercy follow you all the days of your life. You believe it, Misha. God bless you. So next week we take a break, and the week after we come with a new topic, and we will notify what is the topic that we study. Have a blessed, blessed evening. The Lord loves you. He cares for you, and he wants the center of your heart. Amen. Don't give it to anything else. Bless you.
Will you be my light when I cannot see? And when I can't take another step, Lord, would you carry me? And when I've lost my fight, will you be my strength? And will you set me a table in the presence of my enemies? I shall not want, I shall not want. Oh, my soul's got a shepherd in the valley, and I shall not want. I shall not want. I shall not want. 'Cause my cup's running over, and I shall not want. And I will lift my eyes to where my help comes from. And I won't be afraid of the shadow, 'cause I've seen the sun. No, I will not stop when the way gets hard, 'cause the green only grows in the valley, and that's where you are. Say, I shall not. Shepherd in the valley, and I shall not want. I shall not want. I shall not want. when this life is over, I'm gonna live again. I'm gonna trade this cross for a crown. No, this is not the end. And when you call my name, I will take my right. There's a mansion in glory, and you're gonna meet me there. I shall not walk. I shall not walk. He will wipe every tear from my eyes. I shall not walk. I shall not walk. When he's on my side, I shall not walk. I'll be home in his presence forever. I shall not walk. For the Lord is my shepherd in the valley. For the Lord is my shepherd when I'm lacking. For the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. I've got everything that I need. Your goodness and your mercy is following me. Got everything. Hey, hey, hey.